everyone. So in this lecture, we are going to talk about a few more things related to non-graphitizing carbons, related to the microstructure of non-graphitizing carbon. So you know that you have graphitizing as well as non-graphitizing carbons, and these can be obtained via heat treatment of polymers. Different types of polymers will give you different type of carbon. You also know that both coking and charring mechanism can give you both graphitizing and non-graphitizing type of carbon. So an example of a non-graphitizing carbon, which is formed by the coking process, is glass-like carbon. And a non-graphitizing carbon formed via charring process is activated carbon. But we do know that there are still a lot of differences in the properties of these materials, the physico-chemical properties of these carbons. That is because of, number one, the chemical nature of the precursor, number two, the mechanism of formation, and then there can be also some other small factors, of course, the process parameters, how high did you heat them, and so on. Okay, so we will come to the properties and so on later on, but first let's see how do these materials look like at microstructural level. So when we talk about microstructure nowadays, because we have these very advanced imaging techniques like transmission electron microscopy, what we can actually see is nanoscale. Even some very advanced TEM imaging techniques can even detect down to the atomic level, resolution you have in those images. Okay, so the point is that we talk about microstructure, then this is the kind of images. So the scale bar in both of these images is 5 nanometer. This is what you see. You see a very small section of your material, but this is how your material looks like at pretty much in a molecular level, if not atomic. Okay, so now here I have these two images. One of them I had, I think, also shown you previously, but these are like much larger images, so hopefully you can see more through these images. Okay, what do you see here? What do you see is this very crazy kind of structure where you cannot say what is what. And the reason for that is this is not a single plane of material, despite the fact that this is an extremely thin film. So when we talk about the characterization techniques, we'll discuss more about transmission electron microscopy. But the simplest way to explain it is that there is a beam of electrons that passes through your sample, transmits through your sample. And that is how you use the beam of electron to see for the imaging, rather than a beam of light. So that is what you are doing here. However, now when the beam of electron is passing through your sample, this also causes some damage to the sample, especially when the sample itself is extremely thin. Why should it be extremely thin? Because otherwise the beam may not be able to pass through it completely, or the electrons will have a lot of diffraction, and that is why you may end up getting very dark images, or you may not be able to see what you want to see. In the case of materials like graphite, where you have nicely organized crystal planes, what will happen? You will have one dark line and then one bright and then dark, one bright, because you have nicely organized crystal planes. But in the case of non-graphitizing carbon, what you see from in these images, non-graphitizing carbons have a lot of curved carbon structures, and some of them also are very large, some are very small, some are stacked on top of each other, some are not. Sometimes you also do not understand what is what, because you see these, this is like a 2D projection. In TEM images, what you see is a 2D projection of a 3D material. So if I have one plane like this and another plane which is very far, it is like this. But when I see the 2D projection, this is how it will look like, this cross. So this is the problem. You will not even see any difference in the intensity of these two lines. Why? Because they are both in the focal plane. So it is very difficult to differentiate between different structures, but it gives you a very good idea of what kind of material it is. And in fact, based on these TEM images, many models have been proposed for the microstructure of glassy carbon, non-graphitizing carbon. Right now we are talking about general non-graphitizing carbon. I will come to glassy and activated separately, because there we'll talk more about the applications and the industrial manufacturing and so on. So in terms of microstructure, let's talk about all non-graphitizing carbons in general. Okay, so as I mentioned already, you will use the TEM micrographs or the interpretation of these micrographs, and you will also use something called X-ray diffraction patterning to understand what is the microstructure of these materials. Now, as I said that TEM, remember that there are two things. One is these are 2D projections of a 3D material or 3D object. And number two, specifically in the case of carbon, because carbon, it's rather transparent to most of the electromagnetic radiation, many of them at least. So what you only see is the edges of your carbon structures. You can call them graphene sheets or graphene like sheets or sheets containing defects and so on, but whatever sheets you have, whatever carbon structures you have, you only see the edges. If you're seeing, you know, from here, then all you will see is you will just see the edges, and the rest of it will look, you know, will allow the radiations to pass through in most cases, unless it's very thick. And so this is why you have this line. This is a kind of structure that you see. Okay, so if you remember these two things only, then you will be able to do a good interpretation of the TEM micrographs. Okay, now when you can see the images directly using TEM, why would you need any other technique, for example, X-ray diffraction, to understand the material, understand the microstructural development of the material? Well, the reason for that is this. You can see that the scale bar is 5 nanometer. So your entire image is that of a 50 nanometer, you know, piece of your material. What you need is the global, especially when you're talking about bulk carbons, you want to know globally if whatever is valid for that very small region of your material, is it just that local area, or this is globally valid? Of course, you can take images at many different points, but still, to get an idea of how the crystallinity develops or how the crystal sizes develop, for example, with heat treatment, temperature, and so on, you use other techniques such as X-ray diffraction. So X-ray diffraction, Raman spectroscopy, there are many such techniques. Basically, the idea is that if you want to understand the microstructure or the crystallinity of a certain material, you need to have certain supporting data, not just the TEM images, because there are not just the fact that it is from a very small region, also the fact that you may have caused some damage to the microstructure because of your electron beam itself. And also, of course, there are so many challenges associated with the interpretation of such images. Okay, so but now we will see some more images anyway, and we'll talk about some microstructural models. So people have been trying to understand non-graphitizing carbons for a very long time, and several models have been proposed, and we'll talk about some of those models. Okay, so the first model of non-graphitizing carbons was suggested or was proposed by Rosalind Franklin in 1951, and it looked something like this. Okay, Rosalind Franklin was one of the first scientists to classify or to differentiate between graphitizing and non-graphitizing carbons. So here I have only shown the image that she proposed for non-graphitizing carbons. But the one for graphitizing carbons and so on, you can see in her paper, the original paper. I have provided all the references on the last slide, just because you know, there were too many papers to read. So I'm going to describe like four models here, and then there are also several models for non-graphitizing carbons that have been proposed, but they are you know, there was not so much discussion on those models. But anyway, so I'm basically going to show you three or four primary models, but there's still, this is something, this is an active field of research, and people are still trying to understand non-graphitizing carbons. But the very first model was proposed by Rosalind Franklin, and this is the first time somebody said that graphitizing, non-graphitizing carbons are different. So people knew that certain polymers will not give you graphite no matter how high you heat them. This is an experimental fact. But can those polymers also, can those carbons also be useful, or should they also be studied as a different class of carbon materials? So these were the things that, you know, for the first time after this classification, based on X-ray diffraction studies, which was done by Rosalind Franklin, then people started sort of studying non-graphitizing carbons as, you know, as a completely different class of materials, carbon materials. Okay, so at that time, well, transmission electron microscopy did exist in the 1950s also, but it was not so common as we have it today. So it was also the microscopy technique itself was in its developmental phase, and X-ray diffraction was the most common technique used for understanding the carbon materials. So this study by Franklin is based on XRD. In fact, what is very interesting about this paper is that it's a very detailed analysis of how to perform X-ray diffraction studies for carbon materials. So even in that respect, it's a very interesting, very useful paper. So she suggested, as you can see in this picture, that we have randomly oriented graphitic crystallites. So graphite-like crystallites, and these should be in the nanoscale. So they are short-range crystallites, you know, so up between 2 to 5 nanometer. Or not longer, not bigger than 10 nanometers. So the exact size would depend on the heat treatment temperature. But she proposed that you have these kind of randomly oriented crystallites. Okay. Now, she also suggested that there are these closed pores between these crystallites. Okay. Now, whenever we are trying to figure out a model, what we also need to know, we need to know the physicochemical properties of those materials. So, for example, if you take glass-like carbon, it is prepared by coking mechanism. So, you expect that it will have a very high density because the material is shrinking during its carbonization. It is going through a liquid-like phase. It has also a very very flat surface and so on. So, what would you expect? You expect it to be like really dense carbon material. It is dense compared to some other carbon, those formed by charring. It is dense relatively. But at some point, there are closed pores that are formed. And how do we know that? Because the density is still relatively not as high as it should be. And if there is less density, that means there should be porosity. But the material is not permeable to gases or liquids, which means nothing can go through it. So, how do you have pores and then still nothing can go through it? Then in that case, the material should have closed pores. So, if you see in this image, you have, you know, between these crystallite structures, you have certain voids, empty space. So, they are responsible for the lower density of the material. But at the same time, because they are closed, you do not have any permeability of the material. So this is something which was explained very well by this model. Now, were there also any limitations of the model? Okay, so one limitation was that the nature of the links between these crystallites was not explained. So that is what I mean by cross links here. So you have one randomly oriented crystallite and you have another one, but are they connected or not? Now, you know that these non-graphitizing carbons are also electrically conductive. They don't have as high conductivity as graphite, but they are electrically conductive. If they're conductive, what does that mean? That means there should be a path for the electron to go, you know, to take. Okay. But if the links are missing between these crystallites, then you may not have a good conductivity. So this is something which could not be explained by this model. Okay. Now, of course, at that time, there was no discussion on curved carbon structures. Even the fullerenes were discovered much later in the 80s. So at that time, the curved carbon structures were not explained by this model. At that time, it was also, you know, even people did not even know non-graphitizing carbons at that time. So we are talking about 1950. So these were some of the limitations of this model. Okay. So in the 1970s, came the second model, which also actually became very popular. Even now, a lot of people often refer to this kind of model when they talk about non-graphitizing carbon. But now we are going to learn, are there any limitations? What are the good and what are the not so good things about this model? Okay. So, this model was proposed by Jenkins and Kawamura. And this was based on both X-ray diffraction and TEM. So they also had certain TEM images which they interpreted, and based on that and the XRD data, and that is how this model came up. What they suggested was you have long ribbon-like structures. So you have these long entangled ribbons. So you see the image image B. You have very long graphene-like graphene ribbons, you can call them. This is what was proposed by the authors. Okay, now they also have a certain thickness, so you can call it the LC or the stack thickness. Now, one thing, however, was not very clear in this model was how to calculate LA. So we will talk about that. Okay, Now, are there any other limitations also? So limitations on this slide I have written in red color, and you know, other things in blue color. Okay, so the other limitations, first of all, do you think that it is possible to have such long ribbons of carbon, whether or not it is graphene, whether you call it graphene or not? First of all, it is not energetically favorable to have such long ribbons. However, many people, even there were some other models at that time, which sort of suggested that no, ribbon like geometry is possible because the polymers have chains. So these chains, ultimately they lose their non-carbon atoms and then they convert into these fiber or ribbon-like structures. However, one question is still not clear, that whether, how do these ribbons also laterally grow, and if yes, how long? Because in principle, your crystallites will not be symmetric, you know. When you talk about LA or the crystallite diameter, what are you doing? You are considering an equivalent sphere, and then you're considering the diameter. So diameter in all directions should be the same. But if you have a ribbon-like structure, then the length will be much more than the width. That's the definition of a ribbon, when length is much more than the width. So this consideration, whether we should have LA only, you know, whether we should take it only along the length, or we should also take it along the along the width of the ribbon, these things were not very clear in this model, and altogether it looks like a not so favorable geometry for carbon materials to have these kind of very long ribbons. And of course, if you have these long ribbons, then you're also assuming that you have nicely stacked ribbons, so you have very few non-six membered rings. You're also assuming that you have perfect arrangements, or at least there is a possibility of getting a graphite, it looks like. Maybe you will not get very long crystallites because of the entanglement of the ribbons, but if you have already organized these sheets without defects, or at least there was not much consideration given to the defects, in that case it's also possible that it looks not so favorable, and defects and curved structures and none of these things were explained properly.
Okay.
Now, it is also possible that there was some misinterpretation of TEM images, because when you see the TEM image which I showed you in the previous slide, if you see only the edges, and when you see the edges, it sometimes looks like a ribbon. The structure, very, if you look at the TEM image, you will say that this kind of model is it looks correct. But on the other hand, if you think of it this way, you have one carbon flake. So this is a flake, not a ribbon. So it's a flake, and then I have another flake like this. Even in this case, you will see the two lines, which are my two fingers. Still, you will think it will look like a ribbon, or two ribbons stacked on top of each other, but they might actually be two discs. They may also be two ribbons. So if you see a structure like this, if you see it like this, then you see, you may have different angles to see this kind of structure, but you will always see these two lines, only the edges. So it may not really be necessarily be ribbons. So there may have been some misinterpretation of the TEM images, okay? And as I told you before, that LA, whether we should consider it along the length of the ribbon or width of the ribbon, that is not very clear. Okay, now, then came a third model in the late 90s. Then PJF Harris suggested a third model of non-graphitizing carbons, okay? Now, here he considered a sort of, both previous models and also some of the physical properties of the carbon materials. And he did extensive TEM studies to come to this conclusion. And this was also the time when, in the 80s, then fullerenes were discovered. And now people knew that curved carbon structures can exist. And in fact, they can also be very stable. The discovery of fullerenes did not just tell you that these kind of structures can exist, they also told you that these kind of structures can actually be very, very stable. So based on all of these all of these aspects, then came the third model, which is here shown in picture C, where Harris suggested that you have these curved carbon structures, a lot of them. So this is if you see very carefully, you will see non-six-membered rings also in these curved carbon structures. So these are some simulated geometries. So there can be a lot of these you know, curved carbon structures, and they are just because we are seeing only a 2D projection of a 3D material. So we have many such. So if you have multiple layers of such such structures, then what you will see is this, you know, completely crazy structure that you see in your TEM images. So this is a third model that is suggested, and this is pretty much extensive, entirely based on TEM studies, and it suggests that you have fullerene-like structures. So not necessarily fullerenes, but fullerene-like structures, basically curved carbon structures. That is what is proposed in this model. Okay, now what are the limitations of this model? Well, you can see one thing, that it looks like the ribbons are, the curved carbon structures are discrete. They are not connected to each other. So in that case also, you cannot really explain the electrical conductivity of the material very well. Okay, now another thing is that the model does not really show any stacking whatsoever. It says that you have, you know, it looks like these are all discrete flakes. So is there any stacking between the flakes or between the sheets or not? That is not very clear from this model. Okay. And because of these things, of course, then you cannot explain all the properties of these kind of carbons. However, this, the fact that it is a fullerene-like structure, the fact that you can have curved carbon structures is very useful. Is very useful for us not just to understand the carbon, non-graphitizing carbon, but also other curved carbon materials. And also, you know, sometimes you will just, how these curved carbons are formed from a polymer precursor. So all these things we can understand very well based on this model. So this is also a very useful model. So now you see there are three models. None of them can explain everything about glass-like carbons or non-graphitizing carbons. But each one of them has a lot of advantages, and it tells you definitely certain things. So this is like, you know, you can see that how things developed over time, and how also transmission electron microscopy became more and more, you know, people started using it more and more for microstructural investigation. So you can see from these models. Now I'm also going to explain another model which I and my research group previously had proposed. Now this was also based on TEM studies, but it was in situ TEM. In situ TEM means when a polymer is carbonizing, so you keep on heating it and keep on taking pictures. So how it converts from polymer to carbon. So in situ investigation of this entire process is what we did before, and based on that we proposed this one model. There is no image of that model. So this is in fact one of the limitations of our model, the fact that it's so complex that it's really difficult to explain. You know, if I make the kind of model I'm proposing, then the image will again become so complex that from that image you cannot, you know, then it looks like the TEM image all over again. Okay, so in this, I'm going to also show you some more images from this study in the next slide. What we saw, what was very interesting, is that not just fullerene-like structures, but we also have complete fullerenes in these kind of carbons. So we saw some very interesting, completely spherical looking looking molecules. So this also sort of substantiates the previous models that yes, we have curved carbon structures, but this is the first time we saw also not just curved carbons, but we also have fullerenes. And the interesting part is that these flakes, like the ones shown in the previous model and so on, there are all these curved carbon flakes and sheets, but they are, you know, they can be very different from each other in terms of sizes. So some of them can be just a few angstroms in their sizes, and some of them can be several nanometers. So this is, there is a coexistence of larger graphene-like sheets and very small graphene-like disks and structures, and some of them are also completely closed circular spherical structures. Some of them can also be circular, which, because we only see the 2D circle and sphere, we cannot differentiate. So there we need to use different, what we need to see is how stable is that structure. If there is a circle or a disk, typically it would continue to float, or it will try to bond with something that is or merge with the structure next to it. But if it is a fullerene, then it's highly stable. So these are the kind of things then that in addition to what you see in the images, then you use the other data in order to interpret what you have in these materials. So in our model, we suggested that there is a coexistence of curved and also some flat structures. And you can also have some curved structures with very high curvature. And of course, all of these have, they are in a range of sizes. And of course, the one important thing about our model was that we did not just consider the final material. We saw how it is formed. And there are certain things, for example, the same thing about how do you differentiate between a sphere and a disk in TEM. Well, that depends on the stability with temperature. So when we are looking at the process, you know, while increasing the temperature, then we can see what is the effect of temperature increment. So that is how you can see the entire process rather than just, you know, believing in the final material. And also sometimes when you have just the final material, you're preparing the sample, maybe because you need these extremely thin samples, during the sample preparation itself, you generate some stresses, which will not happen if you are doing the in situ studies. Okay. The limitation, one major limitation, as I said, that this is a very complex pictorial representation. That's why I've not shown a picture here. So the point is that just imagine very, very, very long sheets which are flat or curved, or parts of it are flat and parts of it are curved. And you also have certain spherical completely closed structures, which definitely explains the density of the material, the porosity. No, you definitely have closed pores and voids. So it explains that you actually clearly see fullerene-like structures, closed structures. But at the same time, you also have these very long sheets which are responsible for the electrical conductivity. So you do see a lot of different structures, pretty much everything related to carbon. All kinds of carbon structures are in one place, and that material is then called the non-graphitizing carbon. So, however, the pictorial representation of this model is very, as on date, I mean, I would say it's complicated. And another, because we have done this study in situ, we have done it on one type of polymer, which is which goes through coking mechanism. So, coking means then the polymer flakes are floating. They are allowed to, because they go, this the material goes through a semi-solid type of phase, they are allowed to merge, and they are allowed to join or merge into another sheet, or some sheets are also allowed to separate out because they have a certain flow, a certain movement during their carbonization. Now we don't know if the same thing will happen during charring. Maybe it does, maybe it does not. So this model is currently limited to those non-graphitizing carbons which are obtained by coking. So here is one more image from this experiment that we performed, and here is also the reference to this. If you want, if you're interested, you can read more about it. So you see 600, 700, 800. These are the temperature points. So at around 900 degrees. So this is one. The scale bar here, by the way, is 1 nanometer. So you can see how zoomed in this image is. What is the magnification? So you see that around 900 degrees, you see something that is, that vaguely looks like a circle. It can also be a disc, by the way. But as I said, that based on other parameters, we thought that, you know, it might be a completely closed structure. It is, maybe the case, may not be the case, but you see that these kind of structures are, they start to form during around 900 degrees. And many other, you know, curved structures you can see in this material. So at 600, you will see that the material was like almost completely amorphous. Now, this is the material where you still have a lot of hydrogen, which is almost a polymer. It's not yet, you cannot call it carbon because the impurities are high enough. Then still 700, 800, you have a lot of impurities. At 900, I mentioned that 900 is the point where you get reasonable carbon. So there is a lot of data to support this. Also, the electrical conductivity suddenly changes at 900. A lot of mechanical properties suddenly. So all properties of non-graphitizing carbons typically will have a jump around 900. So between 8 and 900, you will see a sudden change in the properties, which is also clear. You can see from this image. And now you also see that these curved carbon structures are formed around 900 degrees. Or you can clearly see them at that temperature point. And then they are stable. And the last image, number H, where I have written RT, that is room temperature. So that is after cooling. So at 1200, and then you cool it down, you will see that there are minor microstructural changes also during the cool down, because the material now becomes more stable. Okay. So now there are so many other aspects of this carbonization process. You can also see that the hydrogen is released, and then there are certain 5 and 7 membered rings formed, and then there are certain defects, and that is why you have you don't see corners or perfectly angular graphite-like structures. You rather see more curved structures in non-graphitizing carbons. Okay, now why are these curved carbons formed? Because there are multiple reasons. You have completely floating structures which is releasing non-carbon atoms at all points. Now every molecule of this graphene-like sheet that is forming will also have so many other steric problems, like there are so many other molecules near it. It cannot completely spread and become flat sheets. So there are many restrictions when these molecules are being formed. They also have, because polymers themselves contain 5 and 7 membered rings, at you know, they are not all just 6 membered carbon materials, you know, they have also non-carbon atoms. So from the beginning itself you will have these defects are non-6 membered rings, which will give the sheets certain curvature. And when the sheets from the beginning have certain curvature and then somebody's pushing it from all sides, and you know, depends on the how much space does that material have for spreading itself. Based on all of these factors, whatever is the most stable geometry at that given point, which can be 700, 800, 900, or you know, 1500 degrees, whatever is the temperature at that point, whatever is the most energetically favorable and you know, suitable geometry for the carbon sheet, it will take that geometry at that point. And there is also physical constraints. There are chemical constraints, and there are energy constraints. Because of all of these things, you will get the curved carbons from the beginning itself. Okay, and some of them, as I mentioned, can also become completely spherical. If you go to this publication, you will also see some other images where you have completely spherical structures. Maybe in the next at some point, I might also show it. Of, you know, much better spherical structures which are 0.7 nanometers in diameter, which is also the diameter of C60, the Buckminster fullerene. Okay, so what we did in this study was, this was an extremely thin film. One thing that was very important was to ensure that there's no beam damage, which means when you take the image, because your electron beam is passing through the material all the time, so that can damage the material itself. And if you want to take the image at the same point, then it's very, very important that we just click the image and then turn off the beam. During the heating, the beam is turned off when the pyrolysis is taking place. And this was done on a Joule heated plate. So in a way, it is a microfabricated, you know, hot plate, you can say. And that is very nicely controllable. So you can control the heating rate and then also, you know, how long you want to keep it at a certain temperature and so on. So in a very, very highly controlled environment with a very low voltage of the beam, the lowest possible voltage that would give you, you know, a reasonable image. So considering all of these factors, however, you can still not say that this is perfect, because some damage is always possible. Also, when it comes to the interpretation of TEM images, which again we are going to learn more about in our you know, TEM related lectures, in those there are many factors that you need to understand and that you need to you know, consider when you are doing interpretation of TEM images. So based on all of these things, there may have been minor you know, issues also with this model. But now you understand one thing. Definitely you understand is that understanding non-graphitizing carbon is still an ongoing research field. So despite the fact that we have such advanced you know, sophisticated instrumentation, we definitely have been trying to do this since 1951. You know, we are trying to understand the non-graphitizing carbons, but this is just, there are still, every other day there are, you know, new additions to the existing knowledge in this field. And this is why these materials are very, very interesting for us. Okay, now on this slide, I have listed all the references. As I told you, this is also not an extensive list. What I have done is I have rather mentioned, you know, like review articles and so on. So if you go to those review articles, then you will have many more articles. That review article will tell you what to read. The first four, the blue colored references, these are the ones from where I took the images of four different models. And then the other papers are also definitely very interesting. And there are, you know, some of them, for example, also describe different characterization techniques. For example, neutron diffraction analysis, not just X-ray diffraction. And different models, some of them also suggest simulated models, and all of these papers are very interesting. And that explain the structure of non-graphitizing carbon. In some cases, you will see it's just glassy carbon or just activated carbon, but that's also a type of non-graphitizing carbon. Now you know that. So yeah, these are the references related to the microstructural models of non-graphitizing carbons.